Maggie Hurst's surgery's been put on hold. So we've got a lot of people that needs prayer. That those that's lost loved ones. Renee Wagner, her mother's funeral was today. Linda Smith, her arrangements are not set yet. But we need to remember these families. And is there any other prayer requests?
Yeah, there was a couple women came and visited your mother, and I think that was Valentine's, and she's got some balloons there over her bed, and she is still talking about that. She is still, and she, this afternoon, she even said, so she said, I just love looking at them balloons. And I said, well, you got them right in front of the window. You can't tell when I come home or leave. You need to move them. And she said, no, I'm not moving them. I just love them balloons.
They need the sunshine.
Okay.
Robert?
We need to pray for Miss Martin.
I'm sorry.
Yes.
We have a praise report. Dennis has been in the hospital several times with what he thought was heart pain. And I don't know if anybody knows what a traveling nurse is, but he got a lady that came to evaluate his situation, and he has sugar, he has diabetes, and his sugar, I mean, if you have it, you know what this means. It was just dropping right before we went to church. I told him all along it was guilt, but and so, it's such a simple, you know, he would arrive at the emergency room at 1 o'clock in the afternoon and had any food. It's been a lot worse. And sugar was a way low number. So, praise the
Lord. Yeah. I talked to Johnny Wilson this afternoon, Lucy and I did, and he said something attacked his immune system. And I don't know what he did, but it really took him down. And I was asking about farming, and he said, well, I may not have much time left. I'm on dialysis. So it hit him in a mighty way. I don't know what exactly happened to him. But.
And he's waiting. He's needs a liver. I mean, a kidney transplant. He's waiting on that. But it's, he's on dialysis now.
All right.
The Carter family. Great for comfort in their life down there.
Also, remember Kathy. She's waiting for a liver transplant, too. And just lift all these things up to the Lord. Again, this revival. Somebody said this morning, the one in Eastern Kentucky, let's pray that it moves all the way over here. This comes clean across the state. And I think in my heart that God's going to start one right here. So. And Mickey's had it impressed upon him so much that it may be coming out here. We don't know. That's God's will. Yes.
I have a praise report. When I went to the doctor and they got my foot, she goes, wait a minute, we're going to do your A1C, okay? And when she did, it was 7.8 last time, and it went down to 7.2. And that's why it's like in a month or so. And so God is really working on that.
Anyone else?
Remember Amanda Luke, she's had a surgery
tomorrow. Okay. Any others?
Troy's friend, whose mom was not doing well, she did pass away today.
That's the
I don't remember her name.
The name I can't say.
Yeah. God knows,
so. Okay. Yeah, I've got that down there somewhere, but let's remember that thing.
Andre.
No, it was a say it.
It's High something, and a Heismaker, High something or another, but his name is Rick Dupree, so if you'll just remember his family, it was his mom, so it's taken, and his dad passed away at the same thing, so it's really taking a toll on it.
That's good. We need to remember Wally's wife, she tripped over the stuff in the hospital and broke her ankle, so it just goes on and on and on.
I was talking about Andre's mother's patio.
Andre's.
Hat.
Oh, okay. Anyone else?
Pray for a gentleman who's 100 and has just had COVID. Just recently diagnosed with congestive heart.
All right. Any others?
Remember Ruthie and Robert.
Yeah, Ruthie's. She's my Robert.
Hang on.
Robert, remember Tommy? I called him up earlier after church, and he had to work on a theater staging or something. And so I was in Murray for a while today, and he got in the car, and he goes, I got two tests. Is it tomorrow, Tommy?
No, but this week.
This week? He's got two tests. Is it back to back? Anyway, he's got two tests, and so he, you know, he wanted to come to church tonight too, so remember his test.
Okay. Anyone else?
My wife, Melissa, who has a couple issues, sir.
Okay. I think remember Donald Wilson, too. All right. Nothing else. Gail Clapp, please, your purpose.
Well,
we
think
we're
moving your house to me. Yeah. I think pray, Lord, if you honor. We just know that we gain strength if we come to you in prayer.
Yes.
I pray that you just, your will be done.
Yes.
And help Brother Nick, as he brings a message tonight and do his service. We ask in my name. Amen.
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 Good
prayer,
dear God.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Yeah, hope y'all find your appetite tonight.
They got all that food warmed up and had left over. I don't guess Lifeline isn't. I guess maybe it's the other day, you think?
I don't know. So
anyway, that's all right. We're going to praise the Lord anyway. And I hope y'all enjoyed that service this morning as much as I did. There was a really good spirit here this morning. I don't expect nothing less tonight. But we're going to sing a couple of different songs here, so y'all meant to bear with me and help me and all that too. So. But we're going to start out with Here I Am to Worship.
Thank you.
everybody need to just turn around and stare at him.
Well, Jimmy's on the ring.
Good God!
just something about that name. Master, Savior, Jesus, like the fragrance after the rain. Jesus, 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 let all heaven and earth proclaim. King and kingdoms will all pass away, but there's something about that name. Jesus, 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 there's just something about that name. Master, Savior, Jesus, like the fragrance after the rain. Jesus, 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 let all heaven and earth proclaim the kings and kingdoms will all pass away, but there's something about that name. Kings and kingdoms will all pass away, but there's something
all that remains is a fire so bright.
He said he's been doing this for 25 years.
Well, I didn't get to preach this morning, so I guess I'll preach twice as long tonight.
All right.
I'll try to hold you on. Turn in your Bibles tonight to the book of Nehemiah. Nehemiah. We were talking about this scripture the other day, and I got to look at it. And usually, when I drive through Mayfield, and I look at what we see, I think about Nehemiah, the challenges that he must have faced. There's some things, if we want to see things built, if we want to see things brought up, we've got to have some particular things. I'll show you tonight. Chapter 1, Nehemiah chapter 1. The words of Nehemiah, the son of Hachaliah. And it came to pass in the month of Chislu, in the 20th year, as I was in Shushan, the palace, that Hanani, one of my brethren, came, he and certain men of Judah. And I asked them concerning the Jews that had escaped, which were left of the captivity, and concerning Jerusalem. And they said unto me, the remnant that are left of the captivity there in the province are in great affliction and reproach. The wall of Jerusalem also is broken down, and the gates thereof are burned with fire. And it came to pass when I heard these words, listen to what it says, that I sat down and wept and mourned certain days and fasted and prayed before the God of heaven. And said, I beseech thee, O Lord God of heaven, the great and terrible God that keepeth covenant and mercy for them that love him and observe his commandments. Let thine ear now be attentive, and thine eyes open, that thou mayest hear the prayer of thy servant, which I pray before thee now, day and night. For the children of Israel, thy servants, and covet for the and confess the sins of children of Israel, which have sinned against thee, both I and my father's house have sinned. We have dealt very corruptly against thee, and have not kept the commandments, or the statutes, nor the judgments, which thou commandest thy servant Moses. Remember, I beseech thee, the word that thou commanded thy servant Moses, saying, if you transgress, I will scatter you among the nations. But if you turn unto me and keep my commandments and do them, though there be cast out and the uttermost part of heaven, yet I will gather them from the thence and bring them unto the place that I have chosen to set my name there. Now these are all the servants of thy people, whom thou hast redeemed by the great power and by thy strong hand. O Lord, I beseech thee, let now thy ear be attentive to the prayer of thy servant and to the prayer of the servants who desire to fear thy name and prosper. I pray thee, thy servant this day, and grant him mercy in the sight of this man, for I was the king's cupbearer. Father, we thank you for your word tonight. Lord, I pray that you would speak to our hearts tonight. God, as we go about and we watch the process of Mayfield and Grace County being rebuilt, Lord, I think about Jerusalem in that day, how it must have looked like, how it must have felt for the people that were left there, laying in ruins, praying, asking God to move on their behalf. Lord, tonight, I pray that you do that very thing.
Yes.
Move on their behalf.
Yes.
In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Nehemiah was in Shushan Palace. Nehemiah was a governor, actually, at this point. He was the king's cupbearer. I don't know if you realize what that means. That was a job probably nobody wanted. What I mean by that, the king's cupbearer, he had the job of tasting anything that the king drank in case somebody tried to poison him.
Right.
I don't know about y'all, that's not the job that I want. But nevertheless, it took a lot of courage to
to be the king's cupbearer, no doubt. And here in this chapter one, we find that some of his, Hananiah, some of his brethren came to tell him of the goings-on of things in Jerusalem. He heard from his brethren how the people, his people, were doing. Isn't it funny how we can hear people say things and listen to people all over the world, but when it comes to your brethren, when it comes to your people that you love, when it comes to people that you really care about and worship with, it's usually the brethren that comes to tell you how they're doing. And that's what happened. They came to tell him about this, and watch what he does now. As soon as he heard the news about the walls were burnt, the gates were burnt, the walls were tore down, he immediately thought about his people there in Jerusalem, and he had a great burden for the people. So number one, you've got to have a burden. When you hear of somebody's life, it's the same in our lives today. When you hear of somebody's life that's torn apart and their life is just destroyed, torn down, and not just a physical building I'm talking about. I'm talking about people's lives. And also buildings. When Mayfield was destroyed by the tornado, many people, myself included, had a great burden for people in Mayfield, and we still do. But you've got to have to see things happen, you've got to have a great burden. In order, we're talking about revival here, and it seems like it's a topic every time we turn around, but we must, we're not going to see revival, folks, until we get a great burden on ourselves for those that are lost and those that need reviving, the churches around us that need to be revived, the people in our community to be revived. We have to have a burden on our hearts for them. That's when God will hear us. And Nehemiah had this burden. And notice what he did with it. He went to the Lord first. He went to his heavenly King first. Yeah. And he got on his knees, and you heard that prayer. He began to pray. And notice what he said. He said, hear your servant. He said, we have sinned against you, God, and we have committed these sins, and we've transgressed, and we've not obeyed the commandments and the statutes. And it's then in that last part of that verse, he said, and we, me and my house have sinned. In other words, he was confessing the sins of the people. He was confessing his sins. He was confessing all the sins that he was wanting God. He had such a great burden that he didn't leave nothing out. He laid it all on the altar and said, here's what it is, God. We are not worthy to even speak your name. We're a sinful people. And God, I need you to hear me today, because this is a burden on my heart. God, is there anything that we can do about it? Isn't that the way we ought to be? When we have a burden for people, the first thing we need to do is go to the King.
Yeah.
That's what he did.
Yeah.
He went to his heavenly King, but then he went to his earthly King. And watch this, what God... See, God, when he heard his prayer, he went... the Holy Spirit... you say, well, Holy Spirit, what is the New Testament? Or the Old Testament? Yeah, it was. The Holy Spirit went directly to King Xerxes. So, preacher, how do you know that? Well, watch what it said. It said he went to King Xerxes, and he stood there as his cupbearer, or the governor, whatever he was, and the king looks at him, and he said, what's wrong with you, Nehemiah? He knew him well enough. He saw him every day, and he knew by looking at him that he had a burden on his heart. Can you walk up to somebody that you know real well, and you've known them for a long time as a Christian, a brethren, and look at them, and you can almost tell every time what is on your heart? There's something bothering you. I can. A lot of times I can go to Robert or whoever, and if something bothers, automatically I pick up on it.
Right.
You do. When a Christian is burdened, you can see it on their face, in their eyes. And so he looks at Nehemiah, And he said, Nehemiah, what's wrong with you? And Nehemiah says, oh, king, I've got a great burden for my people. He said, what's wrong with your people? He said, those that are left of the remnant of captivity in Jerusalem. The walls have been torn down. The city has been ravaged. The gates are burned. Oh, king, I have a burden for those people. He said, I need to take a 12-year leave of absence. That's what he really should have said. He said, I need, oh, king, if you would grant this, I need to go down and see about my people. Now, me and you, think about that for just a minute. Me and you, if we had risen, that's not even a word, if we had risen in captivity up to the cupbearer,
right,
or the governor, I believe he was governor, what the cupbearer said, and even though he was in Babylon under King Xerxes, his people are in Jerusalem, you and I probably wouldn't even consider going down to see about them people. Well, I got a good job up here with the king.
Right.
I'm doing okay.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, I've got it made. I've got a big home. I've got plenty to eat. I ain't got no worries over here. Why should I bother myself to go to see about them people down there? That's the way we are.
Yeah.
And that's why we don't have revival today.
Okay.
So, the king, watch this. The king, God has already been working on him. He says, what can I do to help?
Right.
Now the king Xerxes, that just don't come out of his mouth. Not on his own. The Holy Spirit prompted him to ask Nehemiah, what is it I can do to help you in your distress? I don't want to see you in this perplexing thing. I don't want to see you let them all cast down. What can I do to help? And Nehemiah said, oh, king, he said, if you would grant me permission to go down to Jerusalem and for me to build the walls back up and fix the gates of Jerusalem so that my people would not be a reproach to the nation of Israel. That's what he said.
Yeah.
King Xerxes looked at him. He said, well, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to send letters with you, and I'm going to pay for it. You go on down there and start building Jerusalem, and I'm going to send you everything you need. I'm going to furnish everything. We're going to pay for it. And you just go on. Don't worry about a thing. Everything is going to be all right. King Xerxes, God had already spoken to him. He didn't even realize it. But now you've got an earthly king paying for a heavenly project. And what Nehemiah understood what he was doing. And he sent letters with him so that he would be safe while he was down in Jerusalem. Ain't you glad today that we've got a heavenly king? And by the way, he sent letters all the way from heaven down to you and I. If you and I would just learn to read his love letter every once in a while, you've got it in your lap right now. The king sent a letter for you and I, and you and I don't even bother to pick it up sometimes and read it. But that's God's love letter to you, giving you the instructions on how to build your life.
That's right.
That's absolutely right. Nehemiah took the letters, and he went down to the princes. They brought the wood. They brought the material. All that he needed to start building Jerusalem's walls and gates. But notice what he did. He had a burden, but you've got to have a plan.
Yeah.
So he walked around. He went around. He got there, and he got on an old donkey and went by night and surveyed the city. He didn't want anybody to know what he was doing. He didn't see. Sometimes when God speaks to you and he gives you a certain mission in your life, and you want to fulfill that mission, but here's what you don't do. You don't go around telling everybody what God told you that's going to come to pass, because those people, believe it or not, even though it's a good thing, are going to be jealous because God spoke to you and he didn't speak to them. I've had people in this church come to me. Well, God spoke to me and told me to tell you that you need to do so this and that. And I 2 months later, and they come to me and say, well, did you do that? I said, no. Well, why not? God told me to tell you. I said, well, you told me, but God didn't tell me anything. He told you. See, sometimes Nehemiah wanted to keep it under his hat. He wanted to survey it for 3 days. He rode around the walls of Jerusalem and just surveyed the damage.
Right.
Praying, looking, asking God, God, is this possible? And he knew it was. He wasn't, listen, he wasn't worried. He knew what he had to do. And so, after 3 days, he called the people, the leaders of the people that were in Jerusalem. He calls them together in a meeting. He said, boys, listen. He said, God has sent me down here to do something to help you. And if you will, I can't help you unless you're willing to help yourself. I was on the phone yesterday with a man. And he's telling me, I need to do this, I need to do that, I want to do this, I want to do that. I just stopped him. I said, listen, I can help you if you're willing to help yourself. If you ain't willing to help yourself, I can't help you, sir. Some people are just like that. And so he goes around by night and he surveys the damage and he looks at the walls and he looks at the gate. The gates are burned and they're destroyed and the walls have toppled down. They've been torn down and the families are still living just inside the walls all the way around Jerusalem. He calls the people together. He said, listen. He said, here's what God, the burden he's given, but here's the plan. He said, I believe we can rebuild this. He said, if you're willing to work, if you're willing to get up, rise up, and do something for God, I believe God will honor this, and I believe that we can rebuild this city wall. After they heard him, he said, now, the reason I know this is because I have talked to my God. That's what he said. I've talked to my God, and my God has assured me that if you're willing to work, we can get this thing done. And so he starts, now that's in chapter 2. In chapter 3, they begin up at the gate, the fish gate, or the sheep gate. And that gate, I'm not going to get into all those gates, but here's what happened. They named off, I think it's 7 or 8 of the gates that we have around Jerusalem. There's 12 gates. But he starts naming those gates. And then it's really a tough read in chapter 3 because you're reading all the people's names and their families and who built what. And it's after this one, another one, after this one, another one. And it just goes on and on and on all the way through all the gates. What was happening was Nehemiah was calling these families. They started, listen to what I started, the reason I started to say. They started at the sheep gate. The work started at the sheep gate. Why did they start at the sheep gate? Well, I'll tell you. The priests are the ones that built the sheep gate. The priests are the ones that began the work of rebuilding Jerusalem. Folks, can I tell you tonight that if we're going to have revival, if we're going to rebuild Mayfield, if we're going to do anything for the glory of God, it's going to take the preachers and the deacons, it's going to take some godly people like you in order to rise up and do the work and say, yes, we can do this with God's help. He can do anything. And the priests rose up and began to work immediately on the wall and the sheep gate. Why? Because the sheep gate was the most important gate. But you see, that's where the sacrifice comes through. They bring in the sheaves. It's by the pool of Bethesda. They come in for the sacrifices. And that what they were really saying was they're restoring the worship in the city.
Yeah.
That's what they did first. And folks, in order for you and I to rebuild our lives, when our lives have fallen flat, our gates are burned, our walls are torn down, the first thing we've got to start working on is our worship, our temple of God, this temple of God. We've got to get it fixed first. You can't go on unless you fix your temple. If your temple's broken, folks, you need to come to a holy God and get on your knees and say, God, fix me first so that I can do the work. See, every date that was mentioned in chapter 3 affected the family that lived just inside it. There was a hole in the wall. The enemy could come in at any time. Oh, you hear what I'm saying tonight? They were wide open to the enemy. They had no protection with the wall down and the gates down.
Right.
I'm telling you tonight that God is the same way in your life. When sin tries to come through, if there's no gate, no barrier there, if there's no wall built up in order to protect your life, in other words, if you ain't suited up with the armor of God, your gate is down, your wall is down, you're susceptible to sin. Sin will creep in through that hole in your life, and it'll get a hold of you, and it will destroy your life.
That's the truth.
Yes.
That's what was happening. The enemy would come in at will because everything was tore apart.
That's the truth.
Nehemiah said, folks, if we're going to build this, if you want your lives built back together, if you want your lives restored, you're going to have to rise up. You're going to have to get up and go to work on this wall for the glory of God. Each family got together exactly what. When I go through Mayfield, I look. How many of y'all notice? When you go through Mayfield today, every day it seems like another house is being built, another wall being put up, another home is being constructed. I drive out on a bypass, and home after home after home is being constructed. What are they doing? They're rising up and saying, let's rebuild this thing together. One family, did you know that Samaritans First, people, Larry, them that are getting those houses out there, you know what they've got to do? They've got to spend so many hours out there physically working on the house with them if they're going to take ownership. That's exactly what Nehemiah was doing. Those families had to go and work on the wall. If they were going to live there, they had to be a part of the work there.
Amen. Amen.
That's a good thing. And so they began to work. And when Nehemiah had a burden, he had a vision and he had a plan. But let me remind you, ladies and gentlemen, anytime a Christian is sent by God with a burden, with a burden, a vision, and a plan, you will face opposition. There's people going to come against that. There's people coming against the city of Mayfield building homes. I guarantee you tonight, there's people up there that are fussing and arguing over walls that are being put up and divided, whether it be the government or whatever it is, and there's opposition on every hand. But yet I see the people are not discouraged. They're not dismayed. They're still building those homes. They're erecting them every day, and that's progress, folks. That's God moving in our community, rebuilding it one wall at a time.
That's right.
That's what they were doing here. They were building their lives together, one wall at a time. You see, sometimes it just starts with one wall. When you watch a home go up, you watch them start the foundation. And they pour that foundation, or they build that foundation floor on that foundation. And you say, man, it takes forever after that foundation. But once that first wall goes up, then it's just like clockwork. It just clicks, and another wall's up, and another wall's up. Those families were putting walls up. They were putting those one brick and see. Every family, I can imagine this in my mind's eye. That family would get up in the morning and go out past their house to the water. And they'd start gathering bricks. And they'd start mixing mortar. And they'd start putting that wall back up one brick at a time, all day long, one brick at a time, one more stone at a time, building that wall back up where it should be. Folks, if you want your church to grow, if you want your community to grow, it's going to take every one of us individually, one brick at a time, putting in one word of God, one kind gesture at a time, building the wall for God and putting it back up, holding back the enemy that's trying to destroy our world. And so, Nehemiah, he had a burden, he had a vision, and he had a plan. they began to worry. Opposition came. They came and told him, Nehemiah, said, come down off the wall. We want to talk to you. We want to make a deal with you. That was Sanballat and all of us. You know what Nehemiah told him? He's standing up there with a brick in one hand and a sword in the other.
Yeah.
He said, why should I waste my time coming down off this wall? I'm doing God's work. I ain't got time to mess with y'all. We're doing a mighty work up here for the glory of God. We're not coming down off this wall. We're not coming down for no reason to talk to you or anybody else. We are on a mission to rebuild our life. We're putting our lives back together. And nobody, even you, said no, are going to tear our lives apart again.
That's right.
And that's the way we have got to be with the enemy, ladies and gentlemen.
Right.
We've got to stand and proclaim. We're not coming down off the wall. We're doing something great for God. God has got us on a mission. And I believe with all my heart. Robert said a while ago, that revival may start here. But even if it don't, listen, if it starts over here around the corner, if it starts right up here in this church, I'm going to get behind him. I'm going to be with him 100% because I don't care where he starts it. I just want to see people coming and their lives restored, their lives being rebuilt, one person at a time, one brick at a time, one person being saved here, one revived over here. It doesn't matter where it starts. All we need to see is a great move of God. That's what I want to see.
Amen.
So tonight, let me remind you, it may seem like a slow process to you. It may seem like it's a painstakingly slow process of rebuilding the lives of the people. We talked about this morning in Sunday school. It seems like for the last 2 years, Satan has attacked our church. We've lost so many saints. And we've lost the numbers, and I don't care about numbers, but it just seems like every time we turn around, something is just devastating, no matter how you look at it. But here we are tonight on a Sunday night, and listen, we're still alive. We're still breathing. We're still serving. We still got a God that's alive. Listen, he's not dead. He's just waiting on you and I to be revived and to rise up and say, go and do the work. Start building the walls, whatever it takes to rebuild your life. God will send somebody to take care of it.
Amen.
He'll meet your needs. Nehemiah trusted God. Trusted him even with his life. Got the king to pay for building Jerusalem back. That's unheard of, folks. But God is the God of the impossible. He can do things that you never would have believed that he could have done. I've seen him do it in people's lives. I've seen him take things and just turn them completely around. What we thought was bad, God turned it around for the good, and he made something positive out of it. Maybe a soul got saved, a bad, bad situation, and all of a sudden, three or four get saved out of that tragedy. I've seen it time after time after time. And then they pick up the pieces, and they walk on, and they begin to build their lives back one wall at a time. That's what we've got to do, folks. We've got to stay with God. We've got to have a burden. We've got to have a vision. And we've got to have a plan. I was reading a story today, 1944. This guy named Trotsky, he was the leader of the Communist Party. Later in years, he brought communism into regions in the East. But there was a day in his life, listen to what I'm telling you. It said he decided one day to attend church. Never had been to church in his life. He walked into that church, into the Sunday school class. And that particular day, the teacher decided he didn't want to go to church. And he made no arrangements for anybody to take his place. That same man walked out of that church because he heard nothing and turned his life to communism and became one of the greatest leaders in the Communist Party. I wonder what his life would have been like had that teacher been there to tell him, thus saith the word of the Lord. His life might have been completely different. So when you want to stay at home and you don't want to rise up and you don't want to get up, and I get tired, I know you do too, but listen, you never know whose life you're going to touch just by simply going to church. Simply asking God, say, God, I've got a vision. I've got a plan. I've got a burden, God, on my heart. And I need to go today because there may be somebody there that needs encouragement. There may be somebody there that their walls have been torn down. God, help me to help them rebuild those walls. There may be somebody there that the gate is wide open in their life and everything in the world is rushing in. God, help me rebuild that gate and shut it for their life, because their life may depend on it. Folks, I don't know about you, but when I read this story about Nehemiah, I see the courage of a king's cupbearer going to the one that knows. Amen. He holds life and death in his hand, and he begs him, and God works on that king and sends him and pays for the job. Greg, come on, we're going to sing. I don't know about you, but when I read that, I see a miracle working there. And I see God working in Nehemiah's life, the boldness that he had, going to rebuild that city. And folks, we've got some Nehemiahs right here in Graves County. We have. What they're doing, they're going and rebuilding the lives of people in this county, in this city. They're right here, working every day. We don't even see it. We look past all that. All we see is a new structure going up. We don't understand the vision, the burden, the plan that God has put in their heart to do the impossible. So tonight, you want to see your community come together and revive? We're going to have to build it one wall at a time. What's it going to take? What did Nehemiah do when he got word about his brethren? I'll tell you what he did. It's in the second verse. It said, or the third verse, it said he went home and he got on his knees. He fasted and he prayed. We'll not see revival, ladies and gentlemen, until we begin to understand what that means. Fasting and praying for a true revival. I'm not talking about a plan B. I'm talking about a true move of God. That's what I want to see. Would you stand with me? See the miracle that he has for you. wants to see you do. He wants to see you know. He wants to see things working in your life. But you've got to call his name. You've got to trust him with your life. Are you trusting?
What a Savior. Isn't he
being late?
The Lord will fight for me, so I'll hold.